Welcome and good evening, everyone. The COVID-19 pandemic is gradually in its retreat, and it has left behind some very valuable outcomes. One of them being that everyone is aware of the importance of membrane components like spike proteins and receptors, and acknowledge their importance in our existence. The studies on membrane protein and how they behave has therefore come to the forefront. So focusing on these lines, we welcomed you all to the 20th episode of Manav Data Science webinar series, where our guest speaker will be discussing how computer simulations are used for studying cellular processes like autophagy. And I'm Ritika, moderating the session today. Today, our very special guest is Dr. Lippi Thukral, who is a senior scientist in computational and structural biology at the Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology, New Delhi. She has been closely associated with our pioneers when they envisioned and conceptualized Manav. Our team is now in our second year developing on that idea. And so we are so glad to have her join us in our initiative through these educative webinars. Welcome, Lippi. So Lippi is one of the brilliant scientists working in the area of autophagy. And for her contributions in this field, she has been conferred the prestigious CSIR Young Scientist Award in Biological Sciences. She has done her PhD at the University of Heidelberg in protein folding, and thereon moved to do her postdoc at the University of Southampton, UK. And then she joined IGIB with a DST Inspire faculty fellowship, where she is currently. And she's also a guest group leader at the University of Heidelberg. Her talk today, titled "How Do Atomistic Simulations Capture Biomolecules in Action?" will reveal ways in which cutting-edge science and computation are wielded together, and how this combination can have a remarkable impact on studies like drug discovery. This and much more about her science and her academic journey will be shared in the webinar today. So we welcome her. And before we get started, I'll just mention a few important points for the webinar. The presentation will be of 40 minutes. This will be followed by 10 to 15 minutes of question and answer session. No questions, therefore, will be taken in the middle of the presentation. So do be active on the Q&A tab below. After this, at the end, I'll take a few more minutes just for announcing our future activities. Yeah, and with this, I hand over the session to Lippi. Welcome once again.
Hello, Ritika, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, I was just, now can you see my slides?
Yes, don't worry. Okay.
So thank you so much for that kind introduction. I'm really thrilled to be here, and I want to thank all the organizers associated with Manav Initiative to organize this spectacular webinar series where, I'm really honored to be a participant today. And I want to welcome everyone who has joined live and also on the webinar series right now at Zoom. So a good afternoon, everyone. I am happy that you could join the lecture. I also want to say welcome to everyone who will anytime later in the future see this presentation, which will be, I have been told, kept on the YouTube, so it will be available. I'll be talking about atomistic simulations. So by the end of this talk, hopefully you will get sufficient details about fundamentals of simulations, and also through examples, various examples, you will be clear of how they're applied to the biological research and what is their impact. And now moving forward, I just want to show you where my coordinates are. I am situated here right now, the second floor of this lovely campus in CSIR IGIB, which is Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology, a building located in South Delhi. And yeah, it's great to be back again, mildly open. And the kind of research we do at IGIB is largely biological, but we are also having a very rigorous informatics unit, which is the big data informatics. And my colleagues in this unit are also working in the spheres of genome sequencing, AI medical informatics, healthcare monitoring systems, to broadly speak. I am largely working in the sphere of high performance computing, and towards, as I said, the lecture is directed to explain our efforts at IGIB in this domain. Now, I just want to brief you, especially the lecture is aimed towards the undergrad students, and I hope that you get an idea as well that what is the scale of data we are dealing with in computational biology right now. And it differs largely by order of magnitude, the kind of data we churn, and also the compute it requires. For example, the healthcare monitoring systems right now in India is largely unstructured in terms of having certain EHRs or the thing which needs to be online. Let's say this is the digital medicine area. The data is in megabytes, largely text-based. We can extend to higher order medical informatics where images are now getting stored and are now retrieved to understand based on the ML approaches whether they are tagged for a certain disease or not. So this may or may not be text-based, but definitely inclusive of more other data types. At IGIB, of course, there is a large focus on genome sequencing. Here, the data is related to what kind of variations are there, how many genomes are sequenced. The order of magnitude here goes high to gigabytes. And then my lab focuses on this extreme right corner of this data in computational biology, because the data that is produced during these simulations are really in terabytes. And also the compute that we require is not just one laptop or one workstations or a particular RAM heavy sequencing project. We require stack of computers, which are known as supercomputers, largely because they are connected to each other for a high parallel job. Now, all these in terms of biology also give a work at different level. For example, the healthcare and medical informatics work at phenotypic level of data. Okay, so this is largely to deal with what kind of blood markers, what kind of images, and all related to directly at phenotype. At mechanism level, there is a lot of data generated from genome sequencing related to variations and comparative genomics, etc. We deal with protein level, biomolecule level data, such as also membrane lipids, their interactions, and so on and so forth. So largely with this framework in mind, I also want to introduce the concept of simulation in a naive way. Let's say that you are interested, if you've heard about molecular docking, two different molecules to be docked to each other. This is a very different kind of species sitting on the other. This is what we kind of achieve with docking. What we achieve with simulations is very different. Here we are trying to, let's say, simulate the roller coaster. How does it feel like to be in the roller coaster? And on a more broader level, there are simulations to also achieve an understanding of how the pilots are trained, etc., etc. So there are umpteen examples in non-biology world as well, where the classical understanding of simulation is important to achieve the faster results or faster hypothesis that can be generated for biologists. So the key points to understand in dynamics are the following: that biomolecules are always in action. They're constantly moving. The movement is occurring on different time scale. and also in different positions across the cell. They vary largely by size. These are very critical point to remember when we think about simulating them. One can see that with short, so throughout this, I've put multiple movies and I hope you're able to see them. These are the two examples of dynamics. One where the lipids, so the right hand side is a membrane. So you have lipids which are constituents of membrane moving at a fast time scale. On the left hand side, you have a classic chaperone protein, which is having this zoom in and zoom out kind of a dynamic to capture the non-native proteins, chaperone them towards the folding components. So you can see both of these events are at very fast scale as well as the slow scale processes to exactly now capture complex biomolecular interactions. Let's say this is just an artistic image of understanding what is going on with different, also in a minimalistic way, different proteins that are sitting on the membrane, or let's say the bacteria that invades a particular target protein of the membrane, what actually goes on, are very interesting questions to now start asking using simulations. And our group, my students, myself, we are very excited and passionate about understanding these complex cellular processes, such as membranes, where you can see here are bound with small molecules. And this membrane is also a bacterial membrane, which I'll be talking about. So these are largely broad questions. And the way we try to achieve this is by simulating them, the behavior of the system. Here, for example, as I said, non-biological examples could be gaming, other examples. In biology, the molecular simulations, the fundamental of it is by solving Newton's equations of motions. So largely the simulations that we do by programs such as Gromax. There are other programs available as well, like NEMD, AMBER, and other tools that utilize the same concept that's based on physics law of motions. So here we have the negative potential gradient of the energy, which is being represented by force. And this is nothing but a molecular mechanics potential, which is the sum of bonded and non-bonded forces that constitutes how the protein will move. And these parameters have been extracted based on ab initio methods and other empirically derived potentials. Now, once we have this understanding of the molecular mechanics potential, which is nothing but a force field, there is at the end, a trajectory which is produced as a function of coordinates and velocities of all the atoms of a given system. This, once produced for a given system, gives us huge access to thermodynamic and kinetics quantities that enables us to extract any kind of dynamic information. A little bit of insights about what I mean by molecular mechanics, that for example, let's say this is a simple chemical system with bonds and atoms. So you can see different atoms. There are three kind of bonded atoms that constitute what I say as bonded potentials, which is nothing but bond, angle, and torsional angles. And these information is highly limited in terms of atoms. So in proteins, for example, there is limited repertoire of carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and so on and forth. How they are interacting in different environment, or let's say in different spheres, is already understood. Okay, so we all know that what is the atom length of sulfide-sulfide bond, or of carbon, nitrogen, so on and so forth. So these parameters are then stored as bonded potentials. Then comes the non-bonded interactions. Now, this is very interesting because the protein is moving and these interactions are what are changing at a given time and T plus one and so on and so forth. So these non-bonded interactions are governed by two forces, one the van der Waals forces and the other is the Coulombic forces. So these parameters constitute, let's say, the input and the machinery of how simulations work. you are more than welcome to read tutorials in this direction as a student, and you know, focus more on tools such as GrowMax, where they utilize this a priori. To now start thinking of what kind of systems to study, they vary largely in what is the size of the systems. So the most precise computer simulation is by quantum mechanics way, where all the atoms are represented. And also, in addition to the atom, it's not the point charge representation, but also the electrons are considered, which largely also define, for example, the catalysis in some reactions, how the transition state is jumped, and so on and so forth. Then with ease of the computing or the size, other molecular dynamics other simulations come into the picture. One is the all atom, where the point charges, as I said, one atom represented as one point is considered, and the electronic motions are neglected, which is largely sufficient to see the protein dynamics. Then comes the coarse grain mesoscale simulations, where there is some level of coarse graining, meaning each atom is not represented one to one, but one to many. For example, the coarse grain simulation of Martini represents one atom bead for four atoms, which is the atomistic scale. So it reduces the size of the system, and hence the way it is computed in terms of time scale becomes really fast. So now when I say of time scale, what do I mean? Where does MD simulation come into being when we already have certain experimental techniques that can capture the dynamics? So to give you a perspective in terms of experiments, here are all the available techniques that capture the single molecule assemblies. And you can see that their ranges are different, and where does molecular simulations come into being? This is changing because the advent of even faster computing is allowing for molecular dynamics to reach even at using distributed computing, even at milli time scale level. But we are comfortably sitting at micro time scale, meaning that we can capture the processes which are at the second time scale. Other than that, there are two other techniques which also provide information on the proteins, which is largely EM and X-ray. And I must say, EM is at a very exciting juncture where they're producing data not just of single snapshot, but also of dynamic assemblies. But time is of value here. So not going into details of all these things. Now, what are the processes that occur at these time scales allows us to construct a research question, meaning that are we able to have that compute power to address that question? So light absorption, proton transfer, electron transfer, these are very minuscule activities that can be now captured. We are also at a level where large scale processes such as channel gating, action potential, and various other interactions can be easily simulated using MD simulations. And also you can see the need to talk to experiments is now there because there is a significant overlap. Now, in terms of Dorothy Ken recent review, I want to also elaborate this particular time scale in terms of free energy. What does it mean, right? So let's say if there is a static picture, you're all aware that protein has a single snapshot that is evolved. That picture has evolved, which means that proteins, as I have said before, are dynamic. So let's assume that it has two states, A and B broad states. And the state is defined as a minimum in the energy surface, and where the transition state is the maximum in that saddle. So here you can see broadly A and B have this microsecond to millisecond time scale shift. And this is the tier zero, which they say is largely captured by broad techniques. And this involves higher free energy. But within this sphere as well, the blue and lighter blue patches are the ones which have, let's say, alternative free energies due to either ligand binding, drug binding, mutations. These protein states are altered, which means that we don't just have static two conformational functional states, but within that we have availability of substates. And this is very interesting because some of these substates are directly directly related to the disease state. And to understand what contributes, what energetic differences, what structural differences contributes to that is a very open question. So coming now to the idea that how do we study this? So there are, for example, processes such as enzyme catalysis, protein-protein interactions, peripheral protein-membrane interactions, and supramolecular binding assemblies, which people study routinely using simulations. And over the time that we've been at IGIB, I've been fortunate to understand all representative examples of all these. So I'll give you some of the story. Broadly, they vary in terms of affinity and selectivity. For example, an enzymatic catalysis would be highly selective, but a membrane protein, or let's say a transient membrane protein sitting on the lipids, will have higher surface area, higher molecular surface area, and maybe promiscuous in nature and not that highly selective in nature. So this is really interesting prospects. If you look at the proteins and you want to investigate further, there are broad spheres in which this can be attempted. And how do we do that? We want to now have a model in mind, which is broad. Let's say what is a simulation addressing, a particular cellular process. And broadly, that would predict a biological reaction. This has to be kept in mind. And also, to understand that, there are many input signals. For example, is the protein activated by certain zinc ions or by certain PTM? So this has to be kept in mind to understand its cellular activity, and henceforth the cellular response can be then studied. So overall, the way I started using simulations was working on a very small peptide called as peptide 115 residue. This was simulated back 10 years back, and we had run all atomistic simulations of 2.5 microsecond, and in total 37.5 microsecond simulations were run. Given the broad question was, if you have an unfolded peptide, how does it fold? So this was an interesting question when people were trying to start understanding the mechanism of protein folding, not just prediction of protein folding, but mechanism. So you have the structure, but you want to go back and ask, how does it fold? So this was my PhD work, where we were attempting to run multiple simulations and understand the kinetics of the process using the folding time distribution. We could compute 1 to 1.5 microsecond as the folding time, which was in close numbers with the experimental folding time. In addition to that, we could also provide the mechanism of how the structuring was happening through specific native-like structuring, or obscuring the native-like structuring. And that is what we propose, that these unfolded peptides also specific in the way they stay non-native for a given time in the cell. And then also constructing the free energy landscape, what happens prior to the transition state, what happens post the transition state. And this was done in my team with Isabella and Jeremy. Jeremy was my PhD supervisor at University of Heidelberg. Throughout this, I will also highlight these career trajectories, milestones, because there are a lot of students in the talk. So just to elaborate that the simulations are a mix of a lot of streams, which you might hear about: biophysics, computational chemistry, computational biology, high performance computing. But at the end, we are all working towards a given biological questions. To be excited about that theme is very important. And the group at Heidelberg was working on various biological questions, but they were utilizing simulations to address these questions. And later in my postdoc, I somehow got tilted to understand membranes, that what is going on with membranes, because membranes are largely an unknown moiety, other than, you know, that they are forming a surface, or they are, you know, either the proteins are now getting embedded into the membrane. Now the view is slowly shifting for understanding that what are the things that govern the selectivity within the membranes. For example, with Saima Khalid at Southampton, we were interested to understand how does a simple molecule, ethane and octane, permeate the bacterial cell membrane. And this was really the outer membrane of E. coli, which is quite complex. So this was, now Saima is at University of Oxford, and I've had a brilliant time to get associated with membranes here. It was really a lot of learning that how the small molecules or how these membranes work, and there are a lot of differential lipids, which I'm not going into detail here. They cooperate to allow a particular small molecule to go further, which I'll be speaking later in detail. And then I came back to India, and the questions that were intriguing were many fold, but broadly we were, you know, putting them into complex interactions. So as I've just explained, is largely working as at a very simplistic scale, small peptides, but then, you know, there are a lot of heterogeneity within the biomolecular interactions. How does small molecule bind to membrane, as I just showed you? How does the small molecule bind to the protein? How does protein-protein interaction occur? And then, you know, boom, how so many interactions occur together. These were the systems I got really interested to work. And one of the now examples that will make it clear that it's really fascinating to work with the computer simulations is when you understand the biology of the process. For example, here, my first PhD student, Arjun, started to work on ApoA1 protein. This ApoA1 protein is the main protein of the reverse cholesterol pathway, where it is known to uptake the cholesterol and convert into a different shape, mostly a bell-shaped, which is a representative of HDL, which we are all aware of checking it in our biomarkers as a sign of cholesterol or the cardiovascular disease biomarker. Now, when this is clear for us, we just took the ApoA1 protein, wanted to understand how does it undergo this HDL molecule, right? Because this is, this is unavailable. So we wanted to understand firstly, what is that shape we are talking about and how does cholesterol modulate that? So you can see that we started with an unbiased way. We started the ApoA1 protein with a lot of cholesterol thrown towards the simulation box. And then how, as a function of time, you can see specific reactions. I can also now start the movie here. Pay attention to two domains that have been colored differently. The blue, which represents the N-terminal and the C-terminal. C-terminal and the N-terminal, the green one, which is largely changing the way cholesterol comes at it. And drives the monomeric shape, which is more compact in nature, to a more pronounced circular shape image. Now, this was really fun to watch. And not just this, Arjun went into detail to work much more, stoichiometry of the cholesterol. So we have a lot of interesting data to suggest that we could pinpoint three stages at which cholesterol was getting updated. One was the binding. So it was happening constantly at two stages. Again, here as well, we had multiple simulations to be statistically reliable. And then also the stages at which we call redistribution of the cholesterol. So protein went for dramatic conformational changes to redistribute the cholesterol, and then subsequently giving rise to the opening. So these simulations were then broadly categorized, as I said, as a stage-wise procedure. And so this opens further questions. One is the lipids interaction, diffusive lipid interactions with the proteins. But what about, as I said, just membranes, which are not diffusive in nature, but have a particular role to play in the cell, which is largely the what is considered to be a castle. But can you imagine a fluid-like castle, right, where the entry and exit of the molecules is controlled, right? So how is it controlled? And we are aware that we constantly give antibiotics and several drug-like molecules to bacterial membranes. So how does that come into picture? So in collaboration with Avinash from RCB, we started out a project with my student Asad to understand the small molecule interactions with bacterial membranes. and we could capture the translocation of that small molecule inside the membrane. But what now? Like, right? What are the questions once you observe an interesting phenomenon? So to give you a perspective that these membranes are not easy to deal with also structurally. The simulations were based on Khalid's model earlier that I have also talked about. This is the inner leaflet, which composes of three kind of different phospholipids. Then we have lipid A chain, LPS sugar, which constitutes the outer leaflet. So, and this is the simplistic representation of a very complex bacterial membrane. I don't even want to go into detail of the tuberculosis membranes. They are even far more complex. So those structures have to be parameterized. In other words, force field has to be available for us to simulate. So these are very technically challenging parameterization work, which is now complete for most of the biomolecules, but there is a long way to go. So here there were three molecules that were given to us by our experimental collaborators to understand, look, we have a differences in IC values. Now, can you predict what's going on? Can we modulate the process? So we started with these three molecules and understood that there is a large deal of intramolecular interactions that are deciding the way in which these molecules are permeating the membranes. And when we saw the details of those intramolecular interactions of one of the molecules, till that time we had no information of how it was experimentally, but one of the molecules was having very rigid dynamics and not plastic at all, but it was occurring in a very exact shape. So those interactions were, in our opinion, or we hypothesized, were critical for its entry into the membrane. And what we did was we went back to the experimentalist that, could you change this? Could you change a keto group of the C12CA backbone to C24 such that these interactions, so let's say the visible hydrogen bond is not observed. So in a way, we are tweaking the process now, right? We are tweaking the process to understand that if what is driving its insertion, and now if we tweak that, could be sea changes. And it was really nice. They went back and tweaked this hydrogen bond, and it was no more showing the permeability activities. And this was really, again, very interesting. So overall, we could summarize that conformational rigidity plays a key role when designing antibiotic-like molecules. And this may be attributed to specific intramolecular contacts within the molecule. And membrane contacts evolve, this I have not shown the data, but also interesting to understand that the membrane intensive contacts evolve at much lesser pace than intramolecular contacts for the bacterial activities. So all in all, these insights give us a direction to follow. As you all know, antimicrobial resistance is on high. We have limited repertoire of antibiotics. Now we need to develop more such antibiotics, or more such. We are in a stage where the pandemic is underway. Antiviral development is highly challenging than the vaccine. Why so? Because we still do not understand the complexity of the small molecule and the way that interacts with pathogens. So this was one of those examples which I wanted to show. More recently, my lab is now also into autophagy, which is a prominent pathway that we study. This pathway is known to degrade cellular material, both in a bulk way and a selective way. But broadly, what happens in this process is the following. There is a phagophore membrane that initiates the process. Cargo comes into being, specific protein molecule comes here, nucleates this phagophore membrane into more elongation C-shaped phagophore, which eventually closes to form a vesicle called autophagosome. The autophagosome is then directed to lysosome to form autolysosomes for final degradation of cellular material. Why does it do that? It does that upon many environmental cues, such as fasting, when our body needs constant, or let's say it is in a need of the energy. Or now of late, it has also been recognized to be selective, meaning that it can target certain molecules and put them towards degradation pathway through lysosome. This was mega interesting on a biology scale as well as on compute scale, because it involves large scale assemblies, as you can see. But prior to that, I wanted to introduce our favorite molecule LC3, which is a biomarker, or which is a marker for autophagy, meaning that its presence defines the initiation and the progression of the autophagic flux. So you can see when the FAGO4 forms a green molecule is all along there. In addition to LC3, of course, the complex or the membrane also invites many other protein complexes which have their defined roles to play. And I'm not going into the detail, but I'm going to talk about LC3 now. LC3 is a peripheral membrane protein that if you are doing experiments on it, you would understand the right image. It is known as a puncta formation, which gives a sign that autophagy is in progress. Now, if you really understand from a simplistic computational model, what does it mean? What does puncta mean? Puncta means that LC3, multiple LC3 are located on this simple membrane of autophagosome. So the question we asked first was the membrane recruitment, meaning how does this LC3 recruit onto membranes? This question was the first one that was interested here and working with membranes. So here you see a membrane. It's a coarse grain simulations developed with the help of Dr. Dhurba Sen Gupta from NCL. And at that time, we started to look at the LC3 another feature that I have not explained of LC3 is that it is tagged with a lipid anchor, which is a phosphodiethyl ethanol amine lipid that was known to be a feature of the membrane associated protein. So we parameterized this particular protein with PE chain, and then we wanted to understand how does it bind. And you know, you can see the way I'm just pausing in between to show you that protein takes sufficient amount of time to orient itself on the membrane and then inserts in a very stage wise manner, which we could decompose later during the analysis. So this represented to us the membrane stage, which was not available before. It was one single cytosolic snapshot of protein that was available. So, you know, you can work on multiple stages, multiple layers of the cellular processes using simulations and enable what was not seen before. So what we could come up with, and in collaboration with the experimental collaborator where Dr. Rajesh Gokhale is also my mentor that time, an excellent constant exchange of information was there. So we could go back with a set of residues to the folks who could now start doing live cell imaging and mutagenesis on those residues that we propose to be critical for membrane association. And you can see the wild type here, again, as the image I showed you is highly full of punctas, started doing some mutations. So the idea is to do cluster of mutations. As I said, these proteins are peripheral membrane proteins, so would interact transiently and hence involve a larger supramolecular surface than what a classical enzyme would do. And you can see the last box is the image where there are no punctas, there are no dots, and the mutation in this combination led to the abrogation of not just membrane binding but also autophagosome formation. So this was really interesting to go hand in hand with simulations. But primarily it opens more question, because when you see punctas, you also see other LC3 like proteins, but that were only recognized as a single protein and are still recognized in many experiments as single LC3B. So the question became even more interesting for us, the recent part, that there are six different kind of LC3s. How do they distinguish? And are they distinguishable? Are they having different features or different functions on autophagosome membrane? Was the question that got us interested. And Nidhi, a postdoc, started to work very extensively on this problem and very persistently to also, this relates to very fundamental question that if you have a classic protein fold, let's say GPCR, how does it bind to diverse ligands or divets, the small molecules? Also at the level of MTB, I'm showing here that there are a lot of non-annotated homologous protein folds, which bind, may or may not bind to same ligands, but have similar folds, highly similar folds. The difficulty arises in their sequences where they differ. So you can see the last column is indeed the LC3 family, where it is composed of a ubiquitin fold. This is a classic ubiquitin fold in addition to two N-terminal helices. But all the LC3 members, which I'm elaborating here, are showing the same fold. So there is one single protein, ADG8, which comes from yeast, and there are six proteins that are there in humans. So now this is not just a high performance computing question, but also a very relevant question for autophagic community to ask, that how does it get these different question, different functions? So there is a binding pocket, which is highly conserved. So one can do a lot of computation to understand that how, what was the binding mode different, what are the possibilities in which it will bind to different ligands. But for to understand that, one needs to carefully look into the sequence-based features, which differ from as low as 31% sequence identity to as high as 83% in this small protein family. What does it tell? It tells us that there are regions that are highly conserved and there are regions that are non-conserved. Classically, the binding sites are highly conserved. Then how do we define the functional diversity is the major question. So to achieve that, we started a very thorough contemporary computational analysis, and it was clear that this family is more complex than just what it seems, because you can see that ADG8 is one protein. There are different number of proteins that are existent in different organisms. And again, this is not just this family, it applies to many more families that are existing and have undescribed functions to extra protein or to additional protein family members that are there. Do we think that they are non-redundant, or if so, then how do we classify that? And if we think they are redundant, firstly, I come from a thought that where I don't think that there is any redundant, there is a reason why protein is there in that family. So you here, you can see a very function specific family by including all the sequences of the proteins from different species, and they all club together. For example, now, if you would not know LGG1C elegans is belonging to which particular function within this broad family, it would come as an ATG8, right? So broadly, people have been able to classify them in these functions, but we don't know what are these individual functions. How are they evolving is another question. We could now do coevolutionary analysis, which explains that if two residues within a certain distances are evolving, is there a pattern? And there was indeed a pattern. If you look at the color of lines, the red is a highly conserved coevolution network. So GABA-RAP families, for us, the three proteins shown below, they're not changing a lot. While the above, the LC3 family, which was having this pink color, which was unique to this particular protein, was changing together a lot. In simplifying terms, we were observing LC3 A, B, C to be evolving at a much faster pace. But there are these structure constraints, and this is what is the beauty about structures. Structure remains the same, sequences is changing, and how does that determine the functional relevance is interesting. So can we, I also am showing some negative analysis here, and negative in a way that there are set of analysis which we have done but did not enable us to see the differences. And I hope the student community also realizes that when we do analysis in computational biology, there's a lot of things to be done prior to achieving the destination, or let's say to have an understanding, reasonable understanding in an in-depth way. So we could see that the superimposed surfaces are marginally different, meaning that if we calculate the surface accessible area for the binding site, which is highly conserved, shown here in blue color, of LC3ABC, we did not see any changes in accessibility. What does this mean? That the broad backbone changes do not alter. So this was not surprising, but this was also not anything encouraging. The same was seen in GABARAP 3 submembers. We saw marginal differences in the C terminal, but other than that, most of the accessibility data was the same. So what if now we just didn't do as a whole analysis of this protein, but we wanted to understand connectedness between the protein through microclusters? And this is a raw data where we immediately could see there are differences. To understand this raw data, you have to see that these are alluvial graphs where N-terminus is binding to another region in terms of hydrogen bond. So this is an extensive hydrogen bonding network within the protein of one particular region, which we are calling as, let's say, N-terminal or binding region or membrane binding region with each other. So these regions were enabling us to see a pattern, and we could see very nicely that all of these individual proteins are having distinct non-covalent interactions that enable them to have stronger interactions within the hydrophobic pocket, let's say here, which reveals altered protein stability, also altered protein-protein interactions. And due to time restrictions, I'm not going in the specifics, but one could now just see, for example, the polar side chains, the way they were involving themselves within the non-covalent interactions could completely alter the way the protein was presenting itself to a ligand. For example, here the protein interaction is very intense and not on the GABARAP side. And one could now also say that if you now defer the binding partner and simulate, how does the reaction change? And this, we were lucky to have the crystal structure of bound Plechichem peptide for all the proteins. When we did the simulation of all those proteins, we could see an altered volume, and in fact the way water was sitting into the binding site was also quite distinct. So we had the water calculation shown here for different peptides. This is the volume occlusion, and these are the snapshots at the 0 nanosecond and the final nanosecond. What is classically done in the top is the deep and shallow calculation of binding pocket, which unfortunately doesn't tell more until unless we do dynamic trajectories of these molecules. Interestingly, once we have this information, you can obtain large scale data, genomic data, of the disease associated mutations such as cancer, map them onto your understanding of these regions, and ask the question, how are now these mutations altering a process, for example, membrane binding? And here we could see substantial number of mutations in these proteins in the binding site region. So the work in my lab presently is addressing these questions. So overall, the summary of this work done to understand the functional relevance was based on sequence-based features to elaborate on co-evolutionary networks, and we could also give sequence exclusive residues. In addition, when we do simulations of just the proteins and also with the binding analysis, we could pinpoint what is attributing the function for each protein. And then, of course, the last not least, the clinical mutations give us an insight on the functional impact. So this immediately can now not just tag the disease associated variants, but also give the mechanism in which they are introducing the dysfunctional activity. And I'm towards the end of the talk, but since the start of the pandemic, my group has been also heavily involved in understanding mutations that have accumulated on the spike protein. And there's a lot of work that we have done in this direction, largely with collaborators and our own lab. For example, the first 100 genomes that came in May 2020, we could address what are the differences with other coronaviruses. And we could there itself see in May 2020, the D614G mutation in India, which has now become a wild type strain. we could also see in reinfection cases what is being attributed to the second reinfection cases, what are the different mutations that have come. And we can now go back to the spike protein region-wise analysis, especially this work by my colleague Mitali Mukherjee was interesting because she was interested in understanding hyper-editing sites within the spike protein. And we could provide an explanation of where the hyper-editing sites are within the spike protein and how does it vary. Our own lab's work, largely driven by two of my students, Saman and Surbhi, have tracked large number of genomes since March 2020, which are available, publicly available. And we found thousands. In fact, now this work is getting updated, is in review, where we are updating the list of mutations. But one could now have ensemble of these mutations, that what was the spike protein like in May 2020 or November or right now 2021 during the recent waves, what changed, how the shape of the spike protein changed during this time is what we have elaborated in our recent preprint, which is now online. So you all are welcome to read it. We are now updating this data to give conclusive evidences that spike protein has significantly altered some of these regions and it has an impact on its antigenic evolution. So overall, the summary has been that there have been significant advances, both sequence-wise genome construction and structural-wise, and the emergence of various lineages and its understanding is critical for us to tap and introduce early interventions. And we are very much involved in this process, and my whole lab, I'm very thankful for being very static as well as dynamic at the same point. Nidhi has joined us recently, Surbhi, Dipanshi, Saman, Akanksha, Shantanu are my PhD student. I'm also thankful to Arjun and Nidhi, who have showed the data today in the presentation, and I want to thank you all with a membrane cake.
That's great. It's really yum. A lot of cholesterol though inside that for me. So this is a very interesting session, and I have got a few questions. Point is, do you want to take it from the recent to the back, or should I start from the beginning?
You are the boss. Yeah, you take it on and I'm happy to answer them.
Okay, so one of the questions that I had was how all these studies that you have conducted on LC3 for saying studying different kind of mutations, altering its membrane binding and everything. And similarly for your the spike proteins, you have studied the evolution of different kinds of, you know, ways in which the spike protein is altering. Could you give us a sense of how this study would go further into interventions like drug designing, or at least understanding that what kind of molecules would actually, you know, how would you get there? Like this, we know. How would you translate this study into some sort of clinical applications where you could say that now this data is ready for clinicians or for any pharmacy people to take it on and go ahead with understanding how to take on the problem like coronavirus, or for some example, LC3, wherever the autophagy disease related to autophagy is concerned, to, you know, take it on from there, from you?
Yeah, that's an excellent question, Ritika. In fact, that's a burning question right now in biology, that how can we tag the disease-associated variants and in real time, tell the clinicians that what is, the outcome of that particular genome. Now, how do we take these studies to that has been shown during the pandemic, right? For example, there have been real-time genomic surveillance data that has been put by countries all across, including UK and India, which have tagged the variants with disease-like mutations at critical domains. Now, these eventually go into different dimensions. One is the pandemic, which is the area in which we are trying to understand what is the impact of that mutation, and sufficient experimental details follow for us to enable an understanding that why we had the transmissible variant we had, right? So this is an explanatory way where we head. The second is what you have asked, that how can this variance in advance help us? Now, this is where, Ritika, a lot of ML is coming into picture in deciding the predictiveness, right? In predictiveness of a variant to be disease-like. And I must say, this is just the beginning of ML in our area, where the data is now, you don't have one spike protein structure. There are hundreds of spike protein structures that are available. So in some areas, it is really possible to do ML where there's sufficient information available, not just sequence level, but also structure level, to enable us to understand, let's say, if I have the data of 100 variants, how are they varying the surface accessibility with the spike protein and ACE binding? If we have that data, then using ML, one can now predict. And this work I know in many groups is right now as we speak happening, that can we now predict if there is a variant that has been tagged in an X country, we already, can we predict the transmissibility, right? So that's the work which has been also, there's a very recent science paper that has done that. So this is active. Now, other than coronavirus, there are also examples where people have done that for monogenic diseases. Why monogenic? Because classically, you know, one particular variant is attributed to a disease. And this has been done because we have a series of genomes and you would like to have a comparative way in which, let's say, a rare disease is to be tagged for an infant, which is recently in news as well, that was done. So how they do that is they compare the genome of X patient with the existing variant information. And if the disease-causing variant is available, the information is enough to propose that the patient under investigation has a rare disease. More complex disorder where multiple variants are attributed are a bit more challenging to handle because there we have a gradient. Gradient meaning that there are a couple of mutations that may or may not be associated in a conclusive way. So there is where I think there's a lot of work still needed, but with more available genomes, with more data, we are at a very exciting pace in this domain of structural biology.
Well, yes. And I have another question that is very closely, you know, related to what a biologist would ask is, what is the accuracy of simulation in vivo conditions? Like, how are you sure that this will work exactly the same way? So I guess you get this a lot.
I do get this a lot. And I think I'm in this business to answer this question, but I've become fond of this question now because I work very closely with experimentalists. And I do think that it is important to acknowledge that we prepare models. What is important to understand from the question is also to say that the models give you an insight which were previously unavailable, right? So let's say if you have to understand a priori that how a vesicle forms, there are no tools and techniques where at atomistic time scale, you are observing these proteins to come together. So firstly, one has to acknowledge that these models provide us with first-time information of these intramolecular interactions. The way to do is two things. It can be hypothesis opening work. And the second is one can easily, in some cases, now extend these output to experimental validation. And I have shown that throughout my work, that it is possible and one may do that. It's dependent on the availability of resources that how and when can do that. But yes, there are two ways in which I would support this. One is completely opening the eyes to the biology community. Look, these structural models have not been shared before, and these are the insights they provide, and they can be large scale, non-experimental validating. So it may or may not be. But the second is where you understand that you provide specific information which can be validated. And then in vivo, those things have been, I have shown at least 3-4 examples in my own cases where we have went back and forth and said, look, this is what we have found. Can you check this? Does it happen in vitro or in vivo as well? So we have seen this. But largely, you know, there are assumptions where we say that this is an in silico work to provide sufficient information. Like given the sufficient information, it becomes really interesting to work at the model preparation as well. So there are both cases which I advocate.
So I have one question that came in the beginning, and I would take this as the last one. It is about the role of MD simulations in evolution. So somebody has asked, what is the role of MD simulations in evolution? This is the last question, though it's time. So,
yeah, right. So no, MD simulation in evolution has not been explored that much, but it's a very interesting topic. Why so? Because evolution in general has intrigued many biologists that why we have what we have in terms of evolutionary changes. There are two ways in which our group is addressing. For example, what are the critical recent changes that have occurred in these biomolecules that have changed their functions? So this can be done in a very nice control simulation where you do the earlier pre-existing molecules with not the changed sequences, and then you take the recent changes and do that. The other is more large scale in silico mutagenesis work, which people do. So they introduce artificial mutations to ask a question that can we now develop a protein in an evolved form? And that I think is also very interesting. So can you now modulate a protein with an artificial set of interactions to gain a particular function? I cannot hear you, Ritika. You are on mute.
So with that, I think I would close down the question answer session. Thank you for this really incisive meeting of, computation and real biology with autophagy molecules and also the spike proteins. Hope we see you around again, and we'll send you the invite. So please do come over again. So one thing I just wanted to remind before I close down is that some of the questions that remain unanswered, which I can see, would be provided to Dr. Tukral via an email. And once she responds on them, we will post them on our website along with this webinar recording. So definitely we'll have it there. The second thing is that do see the link on our chat boxes as well as YouTube and Facebook to put in your feedback forms to claim your participation certificates. And finally, the next week on 17th, we'll be back with another talk by Dr. Swapnil Rane from Tata Memorial Center. And the title of his talk is Digital Pathology, Pathology Informatics, and Deep Learning Applications in Pathology. So with this, I'd say thank you and goodbye, and stay safe until the next time we meet.
Thank you all. Thanks.